political correctness mercifully had not even been thought of when James was racing, and even had it been, I doubt he would have acknowledged it. James said what he thought and did what he wanted, and you know, didn't really care what anybody, you know, what anybody thought of it.
Firstly, I think, you know, I had a fairly well-balanced approach to the dangers of motor racing, which I'd already worked out in my mind and was as comfortable with as one can be with the fact that you can get killed. I mean, that's not a comfortable fact anyway, but I was as comfy with that as I could be. In some ways, there is an attitude amongst racing drivers that when somebody gets killed, to a certain extent, there is a there but for the grace of God go I, and the law of averages says that's one out of the way, as it were.
Yeah.
And a lot of drivers can't take comfort in that, and I think I had a little bit of that, if you like. It's a way to find, make it easier for yourself.
Yes.
James was a sort of, you know, it sounds crazy, but had almost a kind of rock star image, you know, for a sportsman, but a little bit like George Best did. Hunt mania was very potent. I remember at Brands Hatch, when there was a first corner accident in which James was involved and his car was damaged, the race was stopped, and there appeared to be every chance that they would restart the race without James Hunt. And then they began to fear that if they did that, there might be a riot.
I never hit anybody. I stopped on the left, and they just came and piled into it. This way. It's all right, it's not swelling up yet. The corner of the steering wheel. Come on, no, this is a race going on, dear boy.
When he was in a competitive car, and he was giving it everything, he was such an intensely competitive man, a real, you know, a rider of a, you know, a proper racer, and he really got after it, and he was blindingly quick, James, no question about it.
I was naturally worried about the handling in my car, and the first quarter of the race it wasn't good, and then it seemed to improve as things went on.
How remarkable.
Yeah. Can you give me a cigarette? Can I grab that cigarette off you? Thanks.
I am an instinctive, natural competitor, which meant every time I got in a racing car, I can say with my hand on my heart, I tried my best.
It was an immense achievement to win the World Championship that first year. By halfway through the season, Lauda had a big lead in the World Championship. And then, of course, at the Nürburgring, Nicky had his accident. And he missed two Grand Prix after that and completely stunned everybody by coming back at Monza. It was not enough that Lauda wasn't there. James had to win to close that points gap. And that he did. And the second half of that year, I mean, he was just about unstoppable.
I basically didn't fully accept that I was world champion, because everything happened very quickly. It was the press, by the time they'd finished the presentation on the podium, it was dark, right? And then it was the press conference. Well, it was only when I came out of the press room to see that everybody had gone. And then I decided nobody was going to take it away from me, because there wasn't anybody there and nobody was interested. So then I believed it.
James and Nicky were fierce rivals. They were also great friends, you know, which is, as we know, not always the case in Formula One between fierce rivals.
In my era, we had Nicky, if you like, representing one side of the coin, yeah, and myself representing the other side of the coin. Nicky was probably the best ever in motor racing for getting on with the work, pulling the team together, working with the team. I mean, he made Ferrari what they are naturally. I mean, Ferrari were gone when Nicky arrived there in 75, 74.
He said something to me one day which quite shook me. He was working as a commentator by then, and he said to me, you know, I never really liked racing very much when I was actually doing it, which I thought was an extraordinary thing to say, and not anything I don't think I've ever heard any other racing driver say. But once he'd actually retired from it, you know, he came to love it very much indeed. I was terribly upset when James died, we all were. He actually died on the Monday evening after the Canadian Grand Prix. He and Murray Walker were commentating on that race for the BBC, but they were not in Montreal. They were doing it from a studio in London. I was in Canada at the race, and I flew home on the Monday night, got home and played back my messages on my answering machine, one of which was, this voice just said, Nigel, Jay Hunt calling, 6:25 Monday evening, just ringing for a gossip. Give me a ring when you're back, or maybe tomorrow. Bye. And of course, that stopped me in my tracks, because that actually, it was early in the evening he died. And what does one say?
I mean, I still have a problem now, but I can't drive any other way, and I never have been able to. I mean, if I get in a car on a circuit, I drive as fast as I can, that's it.